In all the talk of diets and nutrition and food groups, I don't think there's enough botany. I don't think we talk enough about plants. Welcome to ShapeFixer. I'm Andrew. I'm a nutritionist. I have a biology degree, and one of my majors was botany. So I'm going to talk to you about one aspect of plants that you probably don't know about, and I think it would be very useful for you to know about, especially if you eat plants. Now, plants are living organisms, just like us, just like bacteria, just like fungi, just like every other living creature on this planet. And what all living creatures want to do is live, survive, and reproduce. That is how nature works. Nothing and nobody wants to be eaten, and still less do they want their babies to be eaten. Animals have strategies to avoid being eaten. They run away, they hide, they fight back. What do plants do? They can't run away or hide or fight back. They can protect themselves to a point because, you know, they could have thorns. But mostly, their strategies for defending themselves and their babies, which are their seeds, their strategies involve chemical warfare. So they produce chemicals to stop insects from eating them, to stop fungus and bacteria from infecting them, to stop mammals like us from eating them. If you get lost in the woods and you don't have any food on you and you don't have a cell phone and you don't know where you are, if you are stuck there for too long, you will probably starve to death unless you know a lot about the local plants and which very few you can eat. There are something like 400,000 species of plant that we have identified and labeled on this planet, and about 20 of them make up 75% of our food source. So there are very, very few we can eat. And other mammals are in the same situation. There are very few plants that animals can eat. And animals that do eat plants are quite selective. Cows are very particular. Mostly they just eat grass. A koala bear, for example, in Australia eats eucalyptus leaves and will die if it eats anything else. And any other mammal that eats eucalyptus leaves will die. So we're not exactly spoilt for choice. So let's talk about some of these chemicals that are in plants, because surprisingly, a lot of them are in the very plants that we eat. And thankfully, mostly in doses that are relatively low. So it's not like you fall over dead from eating a piece of broccoli, but these toxins in the plants will build up over time and damage you over time, much the way like smoking cigarettes does. Nobody dies of lung cancer after having one cigarette, but 30, 40 years later, you have heart disease or lung cancer or throat cancer. And if you're very lucky, you survive. But let's talk about plants. So we have done a video on anti-nutrients in plants, and you can look all this up. This is not stuff that I'm making up. And let's just recap very quickly what an anti-nutrient is. An anti-nutrient is a compound in a plant that is there to prevent it being eaten, very often acts as a pesticide in nature, and will interrupt your digestive process either by binding to some of the minerals and nutrients in your food, so that would be in the plant itself or in something else that you're eating at the same time as your vegetables, will bind to those minerals and prevent you from absorbing them. Or in the case of gluten, will gum up your gut so that your food nutrients cannot cross the gut barrier into your bloodstream. So again, they affect your absorption and they cause inflammation. Celiac disease is what results from that particular case. Then you have things like fiber, which form a mesh across the inside wall of your gut and block the absorption of nutrients. And people talk about that as if that's an advantage. Oh yes, eat fiber. It slows down or stops the absorption of too much sugar. Yeah, and everything else. Maybe just don't eat the sugar. So there are a lot of anti-nutrients in plants, saponins, lectins. Gluten is a lectin. tannins, there are plenty of them, but there are other compounds in plants that are just straight up toxic. Right, now, we know sugar, we know all about sugar. We know sugar is toxic, but we also know that your body needs a certain amount of sugar. Okay, your brain demands that you have about the equivalent of a teaspoon of glucose in your bloodstream that's spread right across your whole body at any moment in time. Fortunately, you don't have to eat it. Your liver will make it. But it damages you. It damages your blood cells. It damages the inner lining of your blood vessels. But the requirement to have that teaspoon of glucose is so important that the damage is just, well, it's bad luck. Your body will just have to keep repairing it. So you have a certain percentage of your red blood cells are glycated. That's damaged by sugar. At any time, and you can have that measured, and it's usually around 4.5 to 5% of your blood cells, unless you eat a lot of sugar, which comes from plants make sugar, and then you'll have a higher percentage of damaged red blood cells, and that is one of the measures that is used to see how far you are down the road to diabetes. So sugar itself is toxic anyway, but the real toxins, things like oxalates, which we have discussed in a previous video, which combine with calcium, they pull the calcium out of your blood and it forms crystals, which can go into your kidneys and make kidney stones. About 50% of all kidney stones are actually calcium oxalate crystals. There are other types of kidney stones. It can go into your joints and manifest as gout. Now, a lot of gout is uric acid, but calcium oxalate acids, crystals also have this, are called pseudo gout, which is a weird name because the symptoms are exactly the same. Or these crystals can even build up in your eyes and damage your retina. So oxalates, which are in a lot of vegetables, are pretty toxic. Saponins are a cytotoxic, a nerve toxin. Saponins will damage your liver and your nerves. And saponins, we make soap and latex from saponins. Saponins in some countries are used as a poison to kill fish. So it's poured into the water supply and then all the dead fish are harvested. And in a lot of countries, it's illegal to do that because it makes the fish that much more toxic to eat. Cyanogenic glycosides. That sounds horrible. That's cyanide. And when there are about 3,000 species of plants that contain these compounds, and when you chew the leaves, it releases cyanide. Cyanide is highly, highly toxic. There is no safe level of cyanide dose. People say, oh, you know, the poison is in the dose. It depends how much you have. Well, how much is safe? What is the official safe level of cyanide? There isn't one. If you had wild bitter almonds and you ate like 40 of them, you'd probably die of cyanide poisoning. That's how bad it is. And they're a thyroid disruptor or a goitrogen. They can cause all sorts of thyroid problems and damage your mitochondria and damage your nerves. And if there was a processed food, a produced type of packaged food that required a label, it would have to be declared that this food contains traces of cyanide, and I can't see anybody even buying it. But because it occurs in the almonds, in the cassava, the tapioca, because it occurs there naturally, there's no requirement for a label. So anything that is in its natural form, whether that's animal or plant, you can buy and eat, and it can be sold without any labels or warning labels on it. But there would have to be a warning label if you produced something with even those traces of cyanide in them. Glycoalkaloids, right? Solanine, which occurs in nightshade vegetables, particularly in potatoes. And when your potatoes have been exposed to light and they start to go a little bit green, there's a layer of solanine just under the skin. And that is highly, highly toxic. And there have been cases in the 1960s, in the 1970s and 80s that have been documented in places like Germany and Canada where people got sick, huge numbers of people, kids in boarding schools, people in the army, from eating potatoes where the solanine level got too high. So And that is also, it's a natural pesticide. There are carcinogens in plants that cause cancer. Tobacco, we know. We know tobacco causes cancer. Tobacco has something around like 70 different chemicals in it which are carcinogenic. Do you know that Brussels sprouts have over 100? Not necessarily in the massively high doses, but they're there. These poisons are there in the plants. We all know that we shouldn't eat unripe fruit. Our grandparents knew this. This is not new knowledge. Don't eat it when it's green. It'll make you sick. It'll give you an upset stomach. Why is that? Because of the toxins that the plant puts into the fruit before it's ripe, because the plant does not yet want that fruit to be eaten because the seed is not ready for germinating. When the fruit is ripe, the plant pulls the toxins back out of the fruit and just leaves the sugar, which is a trap in itself, but at least it's not the same kind of toxin, and then the animals will eat the fruit and hopefully the seeds will be dispersed. We pick fruit green now because we transport it all around the world and we allow it to ripen on the ship and on the shelf, so that by the time we buy it, it looks fantastic and it's red and fat and juicy and ripe. Where did the toxins go? They didn't get reabsorbed into the plant. They're still in there. So modern fruit, for all its genetic modification with its extra juice and extra sugar and beautiful colors, is more toxic, even when it's ripe, than the wild natural fruit or fruit that is still on the tree, that you can pick ripe from the tree. And then people talk about antioxidants. And for a long time, we've all thought, well, you know, certain fruits, berries in particular, they're high in antioxidants. And this is because you can eat them and then test your blood and you can see the antioxidant levels. But the antioxidants do not come from the fruit. The fruit have toxins in them that trigger your body to produce antioxidants to try to overcome the toxins that are in the plants that you're eating. So plants trigger the production of antioxidants in your body because they're toxic. The plants are not the antioxidants. Now you can eat plants if that's what you want to do. By all means, of course, a lot of people eat vegetables, but the good news is you don't actually need to. All the nutrients you need are in meat, fatty meat, with salt, fish, chicken, chicken skin. You can eat a carnivore diet and you will get every single mineral and nutrient that your body needs. You can be on a vegan diet or a vegetarian diet and you will need to supplement. You just will. I mean, there are lots of nutrients that you cannot get from plants. You can't get vitamin B12, and it's one of the most important vitamins known to man, is vitamin B12. You won't get D3, you won't get K2, you won't get all your omega-3 oils, you won't get heme iron. A lot of other minerals like magnesium and zinc do not come in the correct form for you to be able to absorb, so you need to supplement a lot. So that's fine. You can be on a plant-based diet, and you can take your supplements, but you need to know about the toxins and about the anti-nutrients that are in plants, because then you are better equipped to actually make a decision about what your diet is. And just one quick thing. Show me another animal, apart from humans, that has an obsession with a wide variety of foods and huge range of colors and presentations on the plate. Doesn't exist. Lions eat zebra, that's it. Sharks eat fish. Cows eat grass. We eat meat and fat. And that's what we are designed to do. And if you don't like that, I can't help you. It's just true. Our social agendas, our political agendas, our religious agendas, our tastes, our social ideas, are all human constructs. They're not based in biology. And by all means, take them into account, especially religious restrictions. Of course, we have to take them into account. But just from the point of view of biology and what's good for you and what you need and making sure you get all the nutrients you need and avoiding as much as you can anti-nutrients and toxins, you are way better off on a carnivore diet long term than you are on a plant-based diet, which is driven by government guidelines going back to the 1970s, which were based on the financial interests of the big food companies and the big pharmaceutical companies. And all that is perfectly documented as well. You can go and look any of that up. That was totally conflicted, not based in science, and somehow, in spite of all the evidence and all the research that we've had since then, we still don't get it and we still believe it. And everybody's getting to the age of 40, 50 and is chronically overweight and sick and on medication with diabetes or heading for diabetes, obesity, heart disease, Alzheimer's, autoimmune diseases. We are the unhealthiest mammals on this planet. And we have all this technology and all this knowledge at our disposal. It's mad. It's this plant-based obsession that we have, and we are not plant eaters. Not in terms of our biology, we're not. We're carnivores, and we should be on a carnivore diet. Thank you for your time. Thank you for watching. Please go and check up on all this. Look it all up and find out for yourself, and at least know, and then decide what it is that you really want to be eating. Thank you very much.